You are listening to the audio production of The Body Revelation, Physical and Spiritual Practices to Metabolize Pain, Banish Shame, and Connect to God with Your Whole Self by Alisa Keeton, published by Tyndale Refresh. This book is read by the author. For supplemental images associated with this audiobook, please visit tyndale.life/body revelation. For supplemental audio materials associated with this audiobook, please visit revelationwellness.org/TBR/still and revelationwellness.org/TBR/move. To my mama, a woman who lived with so much pain while here on earth, but who now dances with Jesus and moves freely. Because of your story and love for Jesus, others will read this book and be set free. To my dad, a complicated man whose need for Jesus led our family to Jesus and whose prayers I know I stand on today. You both now live a life in heaven that your pain made hard to live on earth. This book is for you.
Foreword by Jess Connolly, author of Breaking Free from Body Shame and You Are the Girl for the Job. My story with Alisa is one for the ages. I've played it back a million times to make sure I'm not exaggerating, and here are the broad strokes. I was a woman who desperately needed wisdom about my body. What I thought I wanted was to lose weight. What I needed was truth and healing. I thought I wanted to change my life by changing my body. Jesus wanted to redeem my life by mending my relationship with my body. And in a move that I can only imagine was led by the Holy Spirit, I sent Alisa, who was no more than an acquaintance at the time, an email in the middle of the night asking for help. She responded the next day. Alisa immediately informed me that while she would not promise to give me what I wanted, she'd be faithful to walk with me as God gave me what I needed. And the rest is history. She coached me, corrected me, taught me, challenged me, all with large doses of love and compassion. And there was no going backward after that. The freedom train was rolling. The Spirit of God took over. And before I knew it, I loved my body more. I loved God more. And I was more keenly aware of just how loved I was. I don't know why you picked up this book. Maybe you want to lose weight. Maybe you are sick of being sick. Perhaps the persistent pain in your life has you at the breaking point, or you may just be curious about the intersection of faith in your body. Here's my warning. Buckle up. Stay present. Keep going. You are safe, even if you feel that your shame and pain are very much in danger of defeating you. Alisa is still the kind, wise, compassionate guide that she was for me. Maybe you've tried, maybe you've even had some success at making healthier choices, but still feel stuck. Alisa will show you how to partner with your body to begin processing the pain that has kept you trapped. She will teach you how to move your body and quiet your mind in ways that will bring lasting healing and better health. God is going to use this book to change your life. Alisa has structured the body revelation around the typical parts of a revelation wellness training session. Come curious for the warm-up, enjoy going all in during the workout, and then watch God seal in life change during the cool down. You're never going to be the same again, though it might not be in the ways you expect. Your body is a revelation of kingdom proportion, and God is going to reveal himself to you right where you're at in the good body you're in. Trust me. This book is for you. It's for me too. Your friend in the fight, Jess.
Introduction, moving the bad out of your good body. Some nights, my father didn't come home. The next evening, dinner would be tense. For long minutes, the scratching of metal forks and knives against the porcelain plates was the only sound. I keep my head down, feeling the icy chill from the cold shoulder my mom was giving my dad. He was determined to pretend that all was well. "Hey, honey, did I tell you I'm gonna have to travel again next week for work?" I slunk in my chair, seething with quiet rage. I would eat a hunk of mom's casserole as fast as possible so I could run out the door and hop on the banana seat of my sunflower yellow one-speed bike. When I was a child, the sense of feeling small, unheard, and unseen in my family always seemed to dissipate when I went outside and moved my body. Moving made me feel big, free, and full of possibilities. It also allowed me to forget about how much my parents fought. I would pop wheelies on my bike or roller skate like a disco queen, and somehow that just made me feel better. By the time I was a teenager, any illusion I had of coming from a happy home with two parents who madly loved each other and laughed with their children at dinner time was disappearing. When I needed a hug, I received a lecture. When I needed to be heard, I was asked to do the dishes. When I needed to be celebrated just for being me, I was told to clean my room. Disappointment, loneliness, and sadness burned deep inside me like a fire, and angry outbursts were my only release. Some people choose to keep their feelings swept under the rug, and some people, like me, choose to light the rug on fire. Then at 14, I attended my first group aerobics class with my friend Julie. I laced up a pair of white Keds, threw on my favorite t-shirt and some stinky gym shorts, and headed for Fitness Source, the gym at a nearby strip mall. That initial workout seemed like choreographed chaos to me, but during cool down, I lay very still on the brown carpet as an incredibly warm feeling of comfort and peace washed over me. I'd never felt this feeling before, not with this intensity. It went beyond the feeling of freedom I had when I rode my bike or skated through the neighborhood. My eyes pooled with tears as I lay there gently stretching and wondered, what just happened? Perhaps it was the endorphin rush after shimmying and shaking for an hour in a crowd of middle-aged moms, or maybe it was simply pent-up teenage energy looking for a release. But whatever it was, at that moment, I had the profound sense of hope dislodging my anger and sadness. I could feel it in my bones. It was as if something deep inside my body was telling me everything was going to be all right. Whatever brought it on, I was hooked. With money from babysitting, I purchased my first pair of Reebok aerobic high tops, bought the hot pink spandex leotard with matching belt, which I never understood since it's not as if a tight leotard had a fighting chance of falling down. And I paid the monthly dues to secure my place on a 1,500 square foot of brown carpet with a record player in the corner. For just an hour a week, in a room filled with moms sporting colorful 80s makeup and crimped hair and scrunchies, I found a place I could call my own. For a teenage girl trying to figure out who she was, what she wanted, and where she was going, it was there I first felt safe to work these things out. It was there I began to experience a deeper connection between my heartache and my moving body. It was there I felt empowered in my own skin. I learned how to harness the fire of my teenage angst with a good calorie burn while feeling a sense of belonging. Instead of trying to tiptoe on eggshells around my mom's emotional outbursts and parents' exacting standards, here, I could fumble freely, fall, or even step out of sync with the others and not be scolded. Mistakes were expected, and trying again was celebrated. My passion for learning how to move my body and gain strength while feeling a sense of emotional relief continued to grow. As a college sophomore, I spotted a flyer in the student union about a class on becoming a group fitness instructor. If I could help other people feel as safe and empowered in relationship to their bodies through fitness as I had become, I knew I had found my calling. By the time I graduated from college, I had a waiting list of clients who wanted to work with me, and because of that, I felt loved, sought out, and wanted. I was truly living my dream. I was sure I'd move far, far away from my dysfunctional home life, plus I was helping others. When a fitness trainer I work with told me she thought I'd be a real contender in fitness shows, I began bodybuilding, hoping I'd finally discovered the key to filling the void inside me. Before long, I was bringing home trophies. On the outside, I appeared to have it all together, more money than my fellow graduates who hustled in their 9-to-5, plenty of recognition and awards for a killer physique. But deep inside, my dissatisfaction continued to build. Despite my parents' poor track record, I thought a romantic relationship might heal my aching heart. Yet almost every one of my boyfriends came and went, telling me, "I just don't think I can give you what you want," as they broke things off. Then at 26, I got married. I covered my pain in a white wedding dress and walked down the aisle into the arms of an unsuspecting man. I married Simon, expecting that the love and commitment of one person would heal my hurts and quench the fire that burned within me. Instead, I quickly realized that nothing exposed my chronic dissatisfaction more than marriage. My husband's desire to climb the corporate ladder kicked into overdrive right after our wedding. Instead of candlelight dinners followed by snuggling with him while watching movies on the couch, I was home alone. And when he was home, Simon was a man of few words, or more accurately, a man of no words who had nothing left to give me after a long day at work. My growing discontentment fueled my expectations even more. And like a woman going to an empty well, I kept demanding more from Simon than he was able to give. My irrational, emotional outbursts and my tendency to give my husband the cold shoulder in our warm bed was starting to feel painfully familiar. Turns out, the pain of my childhood, feeling unwanted by an unfaithful father, unseen by a mother with fragile emotions, and unheard in a household with no room for my voice, threatened my longing for the family of my dreams, the family I never had. And there was no way I was going to fail at that like my parents did. As a fitness professional in pursuit of good health, I knew something deep inside me was sick and needed help. My soul was crying out for the unconditional love and attention I lacked in my youth. For years, I had done everything I could think of to push past the pain I'd grown up with. I'd tried to sweat it out, romance it out, and reason it out. Nothing worked. Getting unstuck, moving from the inside out. Then God showed up, or rather, I did. I'd heard about him, of course, but I hadn't given him much thought until my friend Sean challenged me to attend the church where she'd recently met God. After some resistance, I went. I was so desperate and my heart so brittle and broken that I allowed Jesus, the living water, to seep in. He was coming to me in my pain, but had no intention of leaving me there. God was about to turn everything I knew about fitness upside down and inside out. He understood that I needed more than simply changing the shape of my body or taking another lap around the gym. He knew a daily walk of faith with him would restore my heart. But he wasn't going to toss my love for movement aside. I had no idea that when I placed my trust in Jesus, I gave him not only my heart, but my mind and body too. My first book, The Wellness Revelation, taught people how to look at their pursuit of good health holistically with God at the center. Readers were encouraged to consider how their relationship with God affected their relationship to themselves, other people, and other created things, like food. After that book came out, I had conversations with many community and faith leaders. As a way of affirming my message that in Christ we are able to live a healthy and whole life, some well-intentioned people quoted 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 19 and 20. "Do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you, whom you have from God? You are not your own, for you were bought with a price. So glorify God in your body." While I love this passage,
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.